I'm going to have to rely on my computer because of a number of verses I want to quote today. And the problem is that I'm not tall enough for the computer up here. I'm not tall enough. This is... But God is big enough. If you will allow me, I want to just insert right here before I begin. Something that I thought about as I walked to my seat a few minutes ago. Saul had the opportunity to become David's mentor. David became the great king of Israel. The sweet singer of Israel. And Saul could have taken David under his ministry and his covering, and eventually could have taken credit for everything David became. But instead, he allowed jealousy and pride to cause him to go after David and died on a battlefield trying to kill him. That is tragic. And that is the perfect segue into the presentation that I have here now. And the presentation has to do with the word edification. As we flesh out and gain greater understanding of the five purposes, there are actually 10 purposes, but we're focusing this week on the last five. The first five describes who we are. We're Christ-centered, spirit-formed, Sabbath celebrating, all those good things. But these last five, the second set, they describe what we do as ministry. And as this thing spreads all around the world to all of our churches, different conferences are taking them and making them their own. And in Mexico, our Mexican conference, which is one of our largest conferences. By the way, our largest conference in the International Ministerial Congress is here in Africa.
In the country
of Nigeria. Let's salute Nigeria. But back over in Zone 2, Mexico is a very large conference.
Mexico is also our conference case.
Just south of our border in the United States. The Mexican conference has about 700 congregations. With somewhere between 40 and 50,000 members. To God be the glory. And the Mexican conference, they have taken their privilege of adding to these five purposes, they've added edification. And my assignment for the next few moments is to talk about what that means. What is edification? If you have your Bible, please turn to 1 Thessalonians 5 and verse 11. 1 Thessalonians 5:11, and the first part of that verse says, therefore, comfort each other and edify one another. Comfort each other and edify one another. 1 Thessalonians 5:11. Write that down. How do we do that? How do we edify one another? The word edify is derived from a Greek word that literally means to build. In its raw, literal translation, the word edify means to build a house. In fact, in the parable that Jesus told of the wise and the foolish builder, the wise man built his house upon the rock, the foolish man built his house upon the sand. Strangely enough, in that parable, Jesus uses this Greek word. When the wise man was building his house on the rock, literally, a literal translation, he was edifying his house on the rock. This is the basis for our use of the term edifice when we refer to a church building. Edifice and edify comes from the same root. It is not our custom to speak of building a house as edifying the house. However, we speak often, the Bible often speaks of edifying the spiritual house.
Now,
and so we look at Thayer's Greek lexicon, and Thayer says, to edify someone is to actively promote that person's spiritual growth.
And it says,
in Vine's New Testament dictionary, Vine's Dictionary of New Testament Words, Vine says the word edify is used metaphorically to describe the process of promoting the spiritual growth and development of another person. So what I want to do, now that we understand that the word edify means to build a house, to build up. Now that we understand that the New Testament connotation for the word edify is to promote and to seek the spiritual growth and development of another believer. What I want to do for a few minutes is to walk you through some key passages where the word edify is used. If you're taking notes, the first passage to make note of is Romans chapter 14, verse 19. It says, therefore, let us pursue the things which make for peace, and the things by which we may edify one another. Remember that the context in Romans 14 is how we get along.
Now,
In Romans 14, Paul paints the picture of the weaker brother versus the stronger brother. In the church, we have the weak and the strong. And in Romans 14, Paul insists that the stronger has an obligation to the weaker. That I cannot cause harm to a weaker brother for whom Christ died. And here in this verse, Paul says, let's seek the things that make for peace. Let's do the things that edify.
Paul says,
the next verse is 1 Corinthians 10, verses 23 and 24. This is a familiar verse. Paul says, all things are lawful for me, but not all things are helpful. Meaning that it might be right, I may have the right to do it, but it might not be good to do it. Then in the second half of the verse, Paul says, all things are lawful for me, but not all things edify. I may have the right to do it, but if it doesn't edify, I shouldn't do it. How do we make sure that we do the things that edify? Paul tells us in the next verse. In verse 24, Paul says, let no one seek his own, but let each one the other's well-being. Let no one seek his own, but let each person seek the other person's well-being. To edify is to seek the well-being of your brother and your sister. Let's quickly look at another passage. This is 2 Corinthians 13. And verse 10. Therefore I write these things being absent, lest being present I should use sharpness, according to the authority which the Lord has given me for the edification, not for destruction.
Was it when she and a minimum chey, mutual way my bremo, Nesamipa, minimum and inodentine, said you to me a radity and mammy, said Emma and Cosuo, not and yet or say anna, said you at yellow.
In summary, Paul is saying, I have the authority. I have the spiritual authority to rebuke you, to take sharp action against you. But I realize that the real purpose of my spiritual authority is to build up and not destroy. That is an important word for pastors today, leaders today. That the purpose of my spiritual authority within the body of Christ is to build up and not destroy. Let's look at Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 13. Ephesians 4, Paul says, and he himself gave some to be apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some teachers, pastors and teachers.
Now I might be no I have some for a bin way before, a binum as a back for as of for any church for.
Notice in verse 12 why he gives these spiritual gifts. Verse 12 says, for the equipping of the saints and for the work of the ministry and for the edifying of the body of Christ. Very clearly in Ephesians 4, the purpose of spiritual gifts is to edify the body. Notice verse 13. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God. Let's see, I lost my pace. Unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. I think those verses are clear. So let me just call your attention to verse 16. Please drop your eyes down to verse 16. Ephesians 4. From whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body to the edifying of itself in love. Here's a takeaway from Ephesians 4. Effective ministry, effective function, leads to growth, which leads to edification. And edification is where the body builds itself up. Those of you from the medical field, you've studied the human body, you studied biology, and you know that the body has an amazing capacity to heal itself. We heard from the doctor 2 days ago, and he talked about getting our pH balance. When the body functions effectively, it builds itself up, it heals itself. And this is the picture we have here in Ephesians 4. One more passage.
I say it was a
1 Thessalonians 5, verse 11. I read this when we began a while ago, but I only read half the verse. Now I want to read the whole verse. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you are also doing. In other words, as believers in Christ, you have a responsibility to comfort one another and edify one another. And Paul there in that verse is saying that that was happening in Thessalonica. So having walked you through these verses, what I want to do now is summarize the whole thing of edification. I want to help you get a handle on the word edification by just holding up before you several principles that will help you remember this. And I want to begin with number one. To understand the meaning of the word edification, we must remember that the Church of Jesus Christ is still under construction. In fact, in the book of 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 5, Peter says, "You also, as living stones, are being built into a spiritual house." Jesus said, "Upon this rock I will build my church." And we understand from the New Testament that he is still building the church. And what Peter says is that you and I are stones in the building. When each person receives Christ, evangelism, And they're brought into the body. Fellowship. What happens is that they're added to the building as a new brick in the building. The building is still under construction. Number two, we as believers in Christ, we have the wonderful privilege of being part of the building process. The ministry of edification. You'll notice in the passage we just looked at in 1 Peter chapter 2. Peter says, you also as living stones are being built up a spiritual house. Notice the next thing he says. He says, a holy priesthood. You and I are priests and priestesses. We're part of a priesthood. And in the Reformation, Martin Luther and the Reformers, they developed a doctrine called the priesthood of all believers. Because you see, in Roman Catholicism, it was all relegated to the bishops and the prelates and the Pope. And what the Reformers did is that they took the ministry from the clergy and they gave it back to the people. And here we're noting today that as believers in Christ, we're all a part of the building process. Number three, please write this down. The construction process is called edification. Plain and simple, that's what it is, edification. Number four, edification connects the vertical aspect of our faith with the horizontal. As believers in Christ, we have a vertical relationship with the Father, but we also have a horizontal relationship with all those who come to the Father. And the Bible confronts us about this. John asks in the epistle of 1 John, how can you say you love God whom you've never seen and hate your brother who you see every day? We also have the question, actually the instruction, from Jesus himself. He says in the Sermon on the Mount, if you go to the altar to give your offering and you remember that your brother has aught against you, you have a responsibility to leave your offering and go make it right with your brother first, and then come back and offer your gift. So edification connects the vertical with the horizontal. Edification reminds us that our victory is tied up together. We're part of the family of God. And if you're going to make it, I'm going to make it. I can't plan to make it and leave you behind. That's why we edify one another. And so with that in mind, go to the next point, number five. The goal of edification is the building up of the body of Christ. Number six. That's very simple. So I won't deliberate. We're smart people. Number six. We edify or build up the church through our shape. Say We build up the church. We edify through our shape. S-H-A-P-E. It is an acronym for, number one, if you're taking notes, we have a shape. You and I have a shape. We won't describe each other's shapes. We have a shape. S is for spiritual gifts. H is for heart. A is for ability. P is for personality. And E is for experience. I want to just spend a moment on those because I want to make sure you get this. S is for spiritual gifts. And you and I have spiritual gifts. We have spiritual gifts recorded in the Bible. There are three passages in the Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Romans 12, Ephesians 4, where we have the spiritual gifts. Some of you don't know what your spiritual gift is. It's different from your talent. Your spiritual gift is a supernatural ability that God gives you through the filling of the Spirit. And the good news is, according to Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, every believer has at least one spiritual gift. Some of us 2, 3, and 4, 5. But everybody has at least one. Can we say amen for that? That's where your shape begins. That's where your ministry of edification in the body begins. That's why in Ephesians 4, as Paul talks about the gifts, he says the purpose of the gifts is to edify the body. But your shape not only includes your spiritual gifts, it includes your heart. Heart is my passion. The thing that keeps me up at night. The thing I sing about. The thing I dream about. The thing I cry about. So you have heart. It's part of your shape. Then you have ability. An ability is our natural born talents. The way we are wired, just the natural way we are, the way God made us. And then we have personality. And all of us have a personality trait. And many of us know the four main personality traits. And I'll just say them quickly. The four basic traits are sanguine, choleric, melancholic, and phlegmatic. Do you know which one you are? Perhaps you can't get along with a brother or a sister simply because the two of you haven't come to understand that this is just the way you are. And so, brothers and sisters, shape is spiritual gifts, heart, abilities, personality, and finally, the E is for experience. Experience is your journey. Experiences what you've been through, good and bad, Some of you have come through very painful circumstances. Abuse. Some sexual abuse, physical abuse, emotional abuse, all of that come together. Your life experience, your educational background, your history and culture, all of that plays into your shape. And I want you to watch this, because what happens is, think about a building. And the building is made of bricks or stones. And there's a particular piece, there's a particular hole. There is this vacuum right there. It needs a brick, it needs a rock, a stone. But you can't just put any stone in there. It has to be one shape for that space. You can't put a round peg in a square hole. And so shape. Think of how God has shaped you so he could put you as the brick in this part of the building that completes the building, that edifies the building, that beautifies the building. That is the idea of edification. My shape. Who I am. All I've been through. All of my trials, my experience, my passions, all of that together shapes me to be what God wants me to be within the body of Christ. And you'll remember in verse 16 of Ephesians chapter 4 that Paul says, by that which every part supplies. There is a part that you are uniquely created by God to supply. In fact, also in Ephesians 4, Paul says, as each one does his or her share. There's a work for every Christian in the army of the Lord. There's a place of service for every one of us. Those of you gifted in worship, when you lead worship, you edify the body. When we do evangelism, we edify the body, because we add a new brick to the building. When we serve, we edify the body, because we help and we make the church a better church. When we fellowship, we edify the body, because we find our place within the body. When we do discipleship, we edify the body, because we turn a rock like Peter was. Actually, we turn a stone, a pebble, as Jesus called him, into a rock, which he eventually became as a disciple of Christ. And so, number seven, I'm going to wrap this up real quickly. We are either building up the body or we're destroying the body. You and I are either edifying the body or we're destroying the body. I'm not going to take time to look at these two passages, but I'm going to refer you to them. This is homework. When Paul wrote to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, Paul asked them, he says, do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? Paul is speaking individually. Individually, each of us, our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. But in a later passage, in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, I think it is, Paul asks a similar question, but now I think it's easy for us to confuse what he's saying. It sounds like he's asking the same question. In the earlier instance, he wanted to know, do you not know that individually your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit? But in the later passage, Paul is speaking corporately. Paul says, do you not know that you, plural, are the temple of the Lord? Individually, we're temples of the Holy Spirit. Corporately, we are the temple. And Paul says, in this second passage, he says, I want you to know something. If you destroy this temple, he who destroys the temple of God, him will God destroy. So there is a very serious warning here. You and I are either building up the body or we're tearing it down. And there is a serious warning for those who destroy the body. Paul says, if you destroy this temple, in fact, he's quoting God. Paul says, if you destroy this temple, God will destroy you. And I underscore this today, simply to say that the ministry of edification, which is a ministry given to the whole body, is a very serious matter. And it is, in summary, all about building up the body of Christ. And finally, I want to close by simply offering this analogy. To edify the church, we must think of the church as the bride of Christ. We've had weddings in our churches. And whenever we have a wedding, at least in the United States, typically they play Wagner's Wedding March. Here comes the bride. All dressed in white. And when they start to play the wedding march, all heads turn to the back of the church. Because she's getting ready to walk down the aisle. Now the whole time the groom has been standing up here waiting for her. But nobody comes to a wedding to see the groom. They come to see the bride. And here she comes. And as she comes down the aisle with her flowing white gown, here's what we're thinking. She's beautiful. We've never seen an ugly bride. Every bride is beautiful. Something about the occasion makes her beautiful. And then we look at her dress. And we think purity. It's white. So we think beauty. We think purity. And thirdly, we think posterity. Posterity. And we talk about posterity at the reception. May the Lord bless you with your quiver full of them. That's posterity. May He bless you with children and great-grandchildren. Brothers and sisters, edification is all about the bride. We need to keep her looking beautiful. We need to keep her looking pure. Keep her pure. We need to guard her posterity. We need to protect the next generation. Her children. Her grandchildren. The bride. It's all about the bride. And to edify the body of Christ is to keep the bride looking beautiful. When I woke up this morning, I was wide awake at 3 a.m. this morning. And I was at my computer doing some work. And I heard something outside. And I got up and looked out the window. I heard a familiar sound that took me back to my childhood in Jamaica. And I looked out the window. And I couldn't hardly see. It was still 5:30 in the morning. And my eyes aren't good anyway. But I was able to figure out. It was a lady or a little girl with a broom sweeping the yard. What was she doing? She was making it beautiful. She was tidying the yard. She was beautifying the place. Brothers and sisters, to edify the body is to keep her looking beautiful. To edify the body is to keep her pure. I heard a denominational leader's wife being described the other day. They said the thing about our president's wife that we so appreciate. They said any room she steps into, she just makes it beautiful. Something about her makes beautiful whatever she touches, wherever she goes, and that is edification. So brothers and sisters, I close by admonishing you to edification. Let's keep her looking beautiful. When the bride fights, she doesn't look beautiful. Where there is division and schism, she doesn't look beautiful. But when we build up the body, when we edify the church, she's beautiful. And Jesus says, Paul says, that Jesus Christ is going to come back one day to receive the bride to himself, to present her to himself as a beautiful bride without spot, without wrinkle. Edification ensures there are no spots, there are no wrinkles. In the name of Jesus, let's edify to the glory of God.
Amen.
God bless you. Amen.